how are we going to apply this equation? What is the main application of this equation? Is to find out the pressure distribution in a fluid, more precisely the word is hydrostatic pressure distribution. Okay. Why is hydrostatic? The pressure distribution in a fluid under static condition is called hydrostatic pressure distribution. That is why we said for a fluid under rest there is only normal stress because of pressure. Okay. So, that pressure distribution is called hydrostatic. Also like to mention, which I will discuss later also, when we discuss for a fluid under rigid body motion, there again we will discuss pressure distribution, but we will not call as hydrostatic pressure distribution, we will call as pressure distribution. Only when the fluid is under rest alone, that distribution is hydrostatic pressure distribution. Okay. So, now we are going to use the equation dP by dz is equal to minus rho g to get simple expressions for the variation of pressure in a liquid and gas also. Okay. Now, okay, that is the starting equation. We are going to use it to find pressure variation along height. When I say pressure distribution, it means that we are going to find out pressure variation along height in a fluid at rest. Remember, still we are using the word fluid. Okay. Now, two cases. What are the two cases? First case, where we take for example, pressure distribution in water, in a liquid, which is incompressible fluid. What does it mean? Density is independent of pressure. That is the first case, simpler case. Okay. And very practical case also. Okay. What is the second case? We will consider the case of pressure distribution in a gas, for example, air. What is the example? Pressure variation in the atmosphere. We have some, let us say, atmospheric pressure at the ground level, and let us say you are traveling up a hill, how does the pressure vary? And that is example I am going to take, in fact, as a numerical example. We will see what is the pressure variation from some level to some other level. Okay. Now, in this case, what happens? Our fluid is air, that is why we have here fluid. Now, we are distinguishing very clearly liquid and then gas, and gas is a compressible fluid for which density is dependent on pressure. So, that has to be taken into account when you derive the expression for the hydrostatic pressure distribution. Okay. So, we are going to consider two cases, liquid which is incompressible and gas which is compressible fluid. Okay. One case density is independent of pressure, other case density depends on pressure. Okay. So, now let us take the case of liquid at rest. Okay. For a liquid at rest, you are interested in finding out P as a function of Z. So, what should we do? Just integrate this equation, integrate this equation. So, let us keep pressure on the left hand side, Z on the right hand side, and let us integrate. Now, what are the limits? What are the limits? We will follow this figure from Fox and McDonald, good representation. At some datum level Z naught, the pressure is P naught, that is what is one of the limits. At Z naught, we have P naught, and at some other Z, we have the pressure P. Okay. So, the limits are Z naught to Z and P naught to P. Remember, when I integrate, I have, of course, G is constant. I have taken rho also as outside, because rho is a constant here for the case of liquids. Okay. Now, let us do the integration, a very simple integration. P minus P naught is equal to minus rho G Z minus Z naught. Okay. Remember, our Z increases in this direction and decreases in this direction, in this direction. Okay. Now, according to that nomenclature, Z minus Z naught is negative, Z minus Z naught is negative. So, we will write as Z naught minus Z. What is Z naught is here and Z is here, and Z naught minus Z is positive, which we will call as H, which is the depth. Okay. So, instead of working in terms of Z minus Z naught, we will write as Z naught minus Z, because Z minus Z naught is negative. Okay. So, Z naught minus Z is positive, which we will call as H, which is the depth. Okay. So, how does this equation get simplified? P on the left hand side, P naught on the right hand side, and then we have rho g h, where h is z naught minus z. Please remember z naught is at a higher level, z is here. So, this difference as a positive number is h. So, we can call it as h as depth. Okay. Now, if P naught is atmospheric pressure, if this atmospheric pressure, what does it mean? Of course, here you have a closed box, assume it, the box is open and you have the surface here open to atmosphere, and how does the pressure vary along the depth? Okay. So, if P naught is atmospheric pressure, then P is equal to P atmosphere plus rho g h. Of course, it is also to be known to us from our earlier physics classes that pressure increases along the depth, and that is what is given by this equation. This equation is known to you, the concepts also may be known to you. We are doing it more formally starting from the all encompassing linear momentum balance or Navier-Stokes equation. Okay. That is a difference, I would say. Okay. So, let us take a example, I would say very very practical example. In fact, you will also use this equation several times. You may also have a experiment based on this in your fluid mechanics lab as well. Okay. What is the application? We have water flowing through a pipe and we like to know the flow rate. We like to know the flow rate. Okay. One way of measuring flow rate is you have the pipe, let us say you allow the water to collect in a, let us say a vessel, and find the time required for a certain amount of volume to be collected. Okay. That is not always convenient. Okay, because you the water may be continuously flowing in a pipe. So, you cannot, in a lab it is possible, but in an industry or any other case, this method of measurement where you take a vessel, allow water to collect for some time, divide volume by time to get the flow rate is not always practical. So, what we do is we have some kind of restriction in the pipe, different ways are possible. Okay. You will come across different kind of restrictions in your next fluid mechanics course or in lab as well. What we have is a flow nozzle. In principle, what happens is that there is a flow restriction. So, because of a flow restriction, there is some pressure on the, we call upstream side, upstream meaning before the flow nozzle. After the flow nozzle, the downstream side, there is a decrease in pressure because of flow through a constriction, through a restriction, there is a drop in pressure. So, now this drop in pressure depends on the flow rate. If you measure the pressure drop, then you can relate it that to the flow rate, that is objective. Okay. Now, let us read part of the question. The volume rate of flow through a pipe can be determined by means of a flow nozzle located in the pipe as illustrated in figure. Okay. You will come across orifice meters, venturimeters, several examples. Principle behind all of them is that you cause a restriction in the flow. Okay. The nozzle creates a pressure drop, and that is what you have discussed, along the pipe that is related to the flow through the equation. As I told you, if we measure the pressure drop, we can calculate the flow rate. Of course, where k is a constant depending on the pipe and nozzle size. Okay. In this example, we are not going to calculate flow rate, that is simple. If k is again given, you can multiply that with the root of pressure drop and get the flow rate. What we are going to see is how are we going to measure the pressure drop. Okay. Okay. Now, how do you measure pressure drop? The pressure drop is frequently measured with a differential U-tube manometer, and that is what is shown here. This is the U-tube manometer, this is a U-tube manometer, and you have the connecting tubes here. Okay. These are tappings on the pipe. Okay. You have water column here, and what you have here is the manometric fluid. The manometric fluid chosen here is carbon tetrachloride, and usually you color it, and you can also choose mercury as well. Okay. These are the usual manometric fluids. If the pressure drop is less, you choose CCl4, the pressure drop is high, you choose mercury. Okay. The fluid flowing through the pipe is water with the density of 1000 kg per meter cubed, and the manometric fluid is CCl4 with the density of 1590 kg per meter cubed. Then what is given to us is this height h1. Now, if you look at the manometric fluid, let me draw that separately here, okay, the U-tube manometer part alone. Okay. Now, if the pressures at A and B were same, then the level of manometric fluid in both the limbs, we call them as limbs of the U-tube manometer, will be same. But in this case, the pressure at B is less because we said there is a pressure drop, and hence the liquid level here, when I say liquid, the manometric liquid level in the right limb is higher than that in the left limb. Okay. And that difference is given as H2. And what is H1? H1 is 1 meter. The difference in the level of the manometric fluid in the two limbs is 0.5 meter or 50 centimeter. We are asked to find out what is the value of pressure drop. It may be a very simple example and simple application of a very simple equation also, but very, very practical as well, okay, both in lab, industry, everywhere. Okay. So, let us start this application, few steps only. We have discussed the pressure distribution in a fluid under rest. So, the fluid in the columns, when I say columns, this is a column, this is a column, and these two are columns. The fluid in these columns are under rest, but what is the fluid? That depends. Here you have water, here you have CCl4, here again water. Okay. So, pressure variation in the manometer tubes is hydrostatic, that is a point. We have discussed hydrostatic pressure distribution. So, we can apply only for the case where the fluids are under static condition. Though there is flow here, there is no flow in these columns, okay. They are under static condition. And we have seen the relationship that pressure increases with the depth according to the relation, that is the equation we have to write. Put little more in a general way, P bottom is equal to P top plus rho gh, instead of writing atmosphere, P etcetera, P bottom is equal to P top plus rho gh. Okay. Now, the way in which we do usual, you will come across several such problems in fluid mechanics book. The procedure is same for most of them. The way in which we start is, we start at one end and reach the other end. That is what we are going to do now, going through the different columns. So, let us start doing that. We start at PA. Now, we will go to point 1. Now, we are going up the column of fluid. We are going up the column of water column. So, there is a decrease in pressure. So, that is why a minus sign here. What is the height? H1. What is the fluid? Water. So, rho water into g. Remember, g is just 9.81. Now, these two points 1 and 2 are at the same level in the same fluid, that is water. So, pressures at these locations are same. Now, once again, pressures at 2 and 3 are same because we are in the same fluid, but now CCl4. So, pressure at 3 and pressure at 2 are same. Now, we will once again move up the column. Now, what is the fluid? CCl4. So, once again there is a decrease in pressure. What is the decrease in pressure? Minus H2 rho CCl4 g, because the fluid is rho CCl4. Now, pressure at 4 and 5 are same because we are in the same fluid, that is water. Now, we will have to reach to position B. So, now we have to come down the column, and the column of fluid is water now. Now, pressure increases. So, plus H1 plus H2, why is it? This height is H2, this height is H1. So, H1 plus H2, fluid is water. So, rho water into g is equal to Pb. So, this steps what you have followed can be applied for solving several problems in fluid mechanics book based on manometer. Different arrangements can be given. Sometimes the manometric fluid could be inclined, or you could use a manometric fluid whose density is lower than water, let us say oil. Different combinations are possible, but general principle is this. Now, let us simplify this H1, this term H1 rho water g, which is minus, and plus H1 rho water g cancels. Okay. And we have minus H2 rho CCl4, and then you have plus H2 rho water. We take it to the other side and you get this equation. And Pb is taken to the left hand side because we are interested in the pressure drop. Always we arrange such that the unknowns are on the left hand side. So, Pa minus Pb is equal to H2 into the density difference into g. Okay. So, what does it depend on? The pressure drop depends on the difference in the levels of the manometric fluid and depends on the density difference between CCl4 and water, of course gravity. Okay. Pressure difference depends on difference in levels of manometric fluid and density difference between the two fluids. Okay. Let us calculate Pa minus Pb. We are given H2 as 0.5 meters, rho CCl4 is 1590, rho water is 1000, g is 9.81, okay, just a number is equal to, when you substitute we get 2.89 kilopascal. Okay. And what is the other use of this equation? Looks like a very simple equation that helps us to select a suitable U tube manometer. What does it mean? Suppose the pressure drop is less and let us say you choose mercury, what happens? You will get a very small difference in the levels of the manometric fluid and you will lose out on the accuracy. You like to have a reasonably large difference in level, not very large, not very small. If it is very small, what happens? You lose out on the accuracy. If it is very large, you will have to design a very long U tube manometer. So, this equation also helps in the selection or design of a U tube manometer. What is the manometric fluid you should use, or what could be the height of the limbs you should use? So, you can use this simple equation to select a manometer as well. Okay. So, lower the density difference, larger is the H2, which means better accuracy is there. Okay. And that is why sometimes you use, to improve the accuracy, if the pressure drop is very less, we use fluid which is lighter than water, for example, oil, which will have density like around 900. So, this density difference is roughly about 600, and if you use oil which has density about 900, the density difference is 100. So, you can 6 times increase the level difference between the manometric, between the levels of manometric fluid in the two limbs. Okay. So, that is the use of this equation. Okay.